The term mechanical energy of a system simply refers to the sum of its potential energy U and the kinetic energy K of the object at any moment of time. Something like two currencies operating in the mechanical energy bank of the object, where if one goes up, the other goes down. So, in this lesson, we'll try to understand what happens to this mechanical energy when only conservative forces act on the system, resulting in energy transfers. That means we will not be considering frictional forces or drag forces that are non-conservative in nature. So, the important assumption we need to make is that the system is isolated from its surroundings, which means no external force acts on the system to make any kind of energy changes inside the system. Then that leaves us with conservative force doing work W on the object within the system. And this force transfers energy between kinetic energy of the object and the potential energy U of the system. So by now, we are familiar with two important energy equations, and these are one, work done is equal to delta K, known as the Work-Kinetic energy theorem, that outlines how the work done by the force is directly translated into a change in kinetic energy of the object. And two, the change delta U in the potential energy is equal to minus of the work done. So, when we combine these two equations, what we get is delta K is equal to minus delta U. And how you can read this equation is that the magnitude of change in potential energy is exactly the same as the change in magnitude of kinetic energy. However, this minus sign indicates the changes in opposite direction. That is, while one increased by a certain amount, the other decreased by the same amount. Then, if we expand both the sides, what we get is K2 minus K1 is equal to minus of U2 minus U1, where you could say K1 is the initial kinetic energy at some time, and K2 is the final kinetic energy at some other time. And likewise for U, or the potential energy, U2 is the final energy and U1 is the initial energy. Now, we can rearrange the terms in this equation by pulling U1 this side and K1 to the other. And what we get is K2 plus U2 is equal to K1 plus U1. And what this equation tells us is that the sum of kinetic energy and potential energy at any point of time is equal to the sum of kinetic energy and potential energy at any other point of time. But we have to remember that this equation holds true only when the system is isolated and the forces acting are conservative in nature. In short, we can say if a system is isolated and only conservative forces cause energy changes, the kinetic energy and potential energy can change, but the total that we term mechanical energy of the system will not change. And this is the famous principle of conservation of mechanical energy. So, if we agree that the mechanical energy of a system cannot change, we can write delta E is equal to zero. Now, let us rewrite this equation as delta K plus delta U is equal to zero. And you will notice that this side is nothing but delta E. Because if mechanical energy E is equal to K plus U, then delta E is equal to delta K plus delta U. So, another interpretation could be the sum of change in kinetic energy and potential energy will be zero if a conservative force acts on a system. So, if you like the way I'm teaching, do give a thumbs up. That'll be helpful. And let's get back to the lesson. So, when you solve numerical problems, you'll find several instances where the principle of conservation of energy helps us to solve problems a lot faster than using only Newton's laws. Simply because when the mechanical energy of a system is conserved, we can equate the sum of the kinetic energy and potential energy at one time to that at another time without worrying about what happens in between or trying to find the work done by the forces acting on the object. So what we have here is a roller coaster navigating the highs and lows of its track, and it beautifully demonstrates the principle of conservation of energy. Now, we can see that the coaster's motion is clearly affected by the Earth's gravitational pull, and therefore we can call this a roller coaster Earth system. So observe how energy is transferred periodically between kinetic energy K and the gravitational potential energy U as the car moves between point A and B, with the total kinetic and potential energy remaining constant at any instant. In fact, if we know the potential energy of the car when it is at its highest point, we can say that that would be the car's kinetic energy at the lowest point, simply because the kinetic energy at the top point is zero, since it momentarily comes to rest, and therefore this potential energy has to be the total energy. And here at the lowest point, potential energy is zero, therefore the entire energy has to be kinetic energy. So if we choose this lowest point as a reference point where the potential energy U2 is equal to zero and potential energy at the highest point is U1, let us say it is 20 joules relative to the reference point, then since the car momentarily stops at its highest point, the kinetic energy there is K1 is equal to zero, and putting these values into this equation gives us the kinetic energy K2 at the lowest point as 20 joules. And it is noteworthy that we get this result without even considering the motion between the highest and the lowest points, and without finding the work done by any forces involved in the motion. So you could say that this lesson is a little conceptual in nature, but not very difficult, provided you go through this lesson a couple of times, because every time you read this lesson, what you will find is that your clarity will go up quite a bit. And I would also suggest you go through this playlist on work energy and power to understand this topic really well. And if you like this lesson, do give a thumbs up, and I'll see you in the next lesson.